guys, it's November 26, 2017, and this is your episode 122 of Epercussion. I'm your host, Casey Kendrilesi, and with me, as usual, is Laurel Black.
Hi.
And Megan Arnes.
Hello.
Ben Charles is here. How's it going?
Hey, I'm doing well. How are you?
Just fine, thanks. So this episode, yeah, like I said, we're recording on the 26th, and it'll be out in about 2 weeks after that. Given that net neutrality isn't totally obliterated and the internet isn't a totally different place. Are you guys all up to speed on all of that?
Yeah.
It's very confusing. And I mean, I think I'm in the majority, which seems like, okay, what the benefits they're claiming it has certainly don't outweigh the deficits, and I just don't it doesn't seem like a good idea.
Yeah
it would be such a action of trust in these companies, which have so many times broken that trust already, that it's like, wait, why should we give you permission to do these things that you've already done, even though you shouldn't have done them,
right?
And trust that you won't do them again, even though now it won't be illegal. Just a little,
right? Like, I want to be a nice person and take people at their word, and a company that says, "Oh no, it's going to be better for you." And it's like, I would love to just take you at your word, but you have a track record of doing the opposite.
When Donald Trump
says, "I never said Mexico would pay for the wall," it's like, wait a minute, yes, you did. I remember. I know for a fact you said that over and over and over, so I would love to just believe you, but I just can't trust you or my lying eyes. So anyway, interesting.
I understand why they would be concerned, though, that our podcast is using up way too much bandwidth because it's so popular.
Yeah. Oh, right. Yeah, it must be. It must
really
be
slowing everything down.
Anyway. Anyway, that's the hot topic issue right now, as the vote is Tuesday, and the timing of this podcast, that's what's happening. So our guests today make the joint venture percussion duo. Together they've performed in some of the world's most prestigious concert halls, including Amsterdam's Concertgebouw, Luxembourg's Philharmonie, and Beijing's National Center for the Performing Arts. Their debut CD is titled Revel, Dances, and Fairy Tales, and is out on BIS Records. So guys, please welcome to the show Rachel Zong and Laurent Varnier. How are you guys doing?
Hi, everyone.
Thanks so much for joining us all the way from Amsterdam.
Thank
you for having us. We're so excited to be on the show.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. So you guys live together in Amsterdam, but Laurent, you go back and forth from Luxembourg, is that right?
That's a new situation for this year. Yeah, where I got a teaching job in Luxembourg Conservatory, and this takes up a few days of my week, but I spend also still, I mean, the rest of the time I spend in Amsterdam.
Yeah, great. And Rachel, what about you? Where are you spending most of your time?
Mostly in Amsterdam. I just really am really in love with the city. I try to move as least as I could from here.
Aww.
Yeah, that's awesome. Well, and Rachel, you teach at the conservatory there, right?
Yes, I do. And also, well, I don't have a driving license, so Laurent had to be the one who moves around.
But wait, you just said that you don't want to leave Amsterdam, so...
No, that's also a very good excuse that I don't have a driving license.
Well, what's coming up for you guys as individuals or for the duo?
Well, maybe with the duo, no? We're here as a duo. Maybe let's start talking about the duo. We have now in December, we have a small residency in the conservatory in China, in Xi'an, where we're going to teach for like 2 or 3 days and have a concert as well and perform with the students together with their ensemble. Just a few days later, our pianist will join us in China. We'll have a concert with a trio that we actually perform regularly together. So with piano and mostly marimba and vibraphone. So that's
Does that trio have a different name?
Yes.
Yes, it does. Yeah. It does have another name, but it's also just known as Joint Venture Percussion and Piano, but we have another name, which is called Machine à Trois. Like a, I guess you understand a little bit the wordplay.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. So yeah, and then there's also wordplay between French and Chinese. So machine is with the, it's all in capital, the A and the E at the end. I write in Chinese letters, which it means three people, actually.
Yeah. Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, and with the trio, well, let's talk about the trio. With the trio, we play mostly arrangements that we did all by ourselves. So there is not much original repertoire for this, but we just thought this is such an exciting way to play in bigger concert halls. Because we always dislike to play with a duo in like the large concert halls. Like, we don't want to really amplify it, and we don't want to play like overplay the instrument. So adding the piano just adds this volume, and we can actually play for like concert halls which have more than 400 or 500 people, and people know the piano much more. It's a very famous instrument, so the programmers, they're always like, oh, there's piano. Okay, let's do this, and. And there's much more, yeah, like we can cross style borders much more. Like we have like an arrangement of Pamethini, of Tigran Hamasyan, of
Frank Zappa,
and
Radiohead.
Radiohead, yeah, wow. All these kind of things.
Who does the arrangements?
All of us.
All of you.
But our purpose is to bring also the music that we like to listen daily live to the stage and to share it with the audience. So
and it's funny the process that we're actually having, because like the pianist teaches us how to write for the piano, and we kind of like teach him how to write for marimba and vibraphone, because he's also making arrangements for us, and so he's learning how to write for the marimba actually. So it's kind of like almost going into composition, like really learning how to write for other instruments that are not your own.
So while we're describing how we want him to write for us, we're actually also learning how it is possible to write for the marimba and the vibraphone, or what we actually like to see in the score, what effects when we like, what would it affect when we read it, and how do we apply it when we play?
And we realize we're super super lucky to find such a pianist, because I don't think like many pianists would like to do that in this kind of ensemble, and like so extensively with this. We have already like I think around 10 arrangements or something like this.
Sure. We've had several. I feel like it's come up twice on the podcast already, once with a composer and once with a very well-known marimbas, where they say there's difficulty blending piano with marimba. And definitely. Laurel has a marimba piano duo, and a piece our colleague wrote, Jason Haney's a real talented composer here at JMU. He wrote them a new piece called Reef Piano Marimba, and man, it's fantastic. It's just sound. I don't know. Do you guys have any opinion about that blend combination? Because the people who mentioned it on our podcast said it's a difficult blend, and they don't like the combination and find it's difficult. And of course, I think absolutely contrary. But have you guys come across that, or has your pianist come across that?
Well, maybe I'll start from my point. Mm-hmm. I actually really like instruments that has different function or has different articulations, whether it makes or not. I like the process of trying to have them combined and see what's the possibility and what other colors actually it creates together. Mm-hmm. And on top of that, we also have a vibraphone. It's something kind of in between. It has a longer resonance, and but also the attack is similar to marimba, but it's different. So we try to blend all these three together, and also in our arrangements. While we are arranging pieces, we would all gather together and to try sessions and see maybe register or length, how to apply it that would create the colors that we like.
Do you have a vibraphone in 440?
442. Yeah, and the marimba too.
Okay. I mean, yeah, I think with any kind of ensemble like this, you have to, yeah, we try to have a moment in like where all the sounds blend, and then there can be a like where we sound really like one instrument, like all three of us together. That was the idea behind the machine, like that we all interlock like little, what is called, these wheels with the teeth.
The gears.
Yeah.
Yeah, like this. Yeah, this thing, like a watch, old watch or something like this. And then there should be another moment where we all sound very different, and like it sounds like we are 10 people to have this kind of extremes in the arrangements.
So I was wondering, these arrangements are they available for purchase? Like, can other people play them?
No, they're not.
You should
not yet. Not yet, yeah.
Because, well, I guess that's a problem everybody has. Because one piece, after we arrange, we don't just play it once. And the next time we have new ideas, and we always thought, well, maybe, you know, there could be some improvements. And it's never the final version that we
wanted. Yeah, they keep changing somehow. Yeah.
Right. Well, they're all by, I mean, well, not all of them, but a good number by people who are still alive and writing new music anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I'm not sure if there's lots of marimba, vibraphone, and piano trios out there.
I don't think so. Not that I know of.
We actually started with commissioning our friends.
Actually, yeah, the first time we actually got together was like a composer brought us together because he wanted to write for those three instruments.
Oh, no. It's the debut.
Yeah. It's an old ass piece.
Yeah. So we won this competition in Holland, and the programmer was really shocked that the two percussionists.
Yeah, it was like a general chamber music competition with lots of string quartets, pianists, and singers, and that's maybe as far as they thought that it could go, and then yeah.
So then when after you get selected, you get programmed in this 10 major concert halls in Holland, and of course when we got selected, the programmer flipped out.
Yeah, he wasn't really happy.
No,
he had to program us now in this 10 concert halls.
No, he's like, yeah. Well, percussion duo. Well. How am I going to make this sound, you know, to attract thousands of people to come to see? And then he was looking at our programs. He said, no, you have to have big names.
Yeah.
Wow.
You can't just play your percussion repertoire. And so, well, luckily we still had 1 year until the tour start. So we went to the programmer's home and he helped us a little bit with, he said, what, you know, oh, sure, you can have this one, you can have that one, but you need more big names. Like we also played a piece by Dutch composer, and then we had to commission a piece mm-hmm. that is written for us. And we also had to play like, you know, people like Steve Reich or John Cage or like whoever that really has a solid name, not just mm-hmm. percussionist knows. So then he also asked us if we could have a pianist involved. Oh. And that's actually where we first start to play with three of us together. Mm-hmm. But back then it was not a trio yet. Mm-hmm. And then we thought, okay, we have a pianist, but what piece do we have?
Well, you did say Radiohead. That's a pretty big name. Did you?
Yeah.
Had he heard of Radiohead?
That was later.
Yeah.
Okay.
That was the first time we played with this pianist.
I
and
see.
That's why then we had a composer friend. We have this composer friend that we really liked his music, and we asked if he's willing to write one piece for us.
So
that's all.
That piece is available, actually.
So I guess a question to go off of that, you win this competition, someone from, I get marketing or production says, I don't know how to market this, it's a percussion duo, and I don't see big names that I'm familiar with. Did you then go ahead and actually change pieces to play?
Yes.
Did you feel like you had to?
Yes.
Okay.
I mean, we were really young. We had absolutely no experience with it. And he seemed so convincing that, you know, it's not going to sell. So you better listen to me.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. So your pianist must be in Amsterdam also, or yes. No?
He's also Luxembourgish, so he also goes back and forth. But he mostly lives in Amsterdam.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Yeah, we all studied at the same school, but we never met. But Laurent knew him because he's also Luxembourgish. Mm-hmm. And so since the first time we asked him to play together with us, we had really good bond.
Well, I think we should go ahead and give you guys a little break from talking and talk about a composer that you have played a duo of. So, Ben, can you tell us a little about one of my favorite living composers today, Jacob Tivy?
So, yeah, I picked this topic because I had seen your recording of his Gold Rush. And then actually I realized later on after I'd already told everyone I was doing Jacob Tivy that I already talked about Jacob Tivy on episode 78 with Brad Meyer. But I decided I wanted to stick with it because I came up with a new sort of angle on Jacob Tivy. So if you're interested in the sort of background and his overall works, go check out episode 78. But I wanted to talk about two sort of pairs of pieces of his in particular. And I want to do them in actually reverse chronological order of their composition dates. So the first one is Barracuda Concerto / Barracuda Solo. So Jacob Tivy was commissioned by the Trump International Percussion Competition in 2006 to write a concerto and a solo piece, which I originally thought that the concerto came first and the solo came later, but he said he wrote them at the same time. So this piece was financed by the Dutch Fund for the Creation of Music. And if you're familiar with the Trump International Percussion Competition, they largely try to create works from Dutch composers, hence the Dutch tie-in there. And this piece was dedicated to Evelyn Glennie, the winner of the 2006 Trump competition, who I'm sure performed this piece in the competition and probably later as well, was a Taiwanese percussionist by the name of Yiping Yang. And it's the title comes from the sort of onomatopoeia quality of the word barracuda. It's this four-note segment that repeats quite a lot in the piece. The piece is written for marimba plus a small multi-percussion setup of two tom-toms, a temple block, a crash cymbal, a hi-hat, and a bass drum, or a kick drum, rather. And the hi-hat and the kick drum, that you put like a wooden plank over both the pedals, and you place them behind you so you can play them simultaneously. It seems like a real pain. I've never played it, but it's also a really cool piece. And actually researching it, I decided I wanted to play it one of these days. And then while I was researching this, I came across another piece I had never heard of called Barracuda Septet, which was an arrangement of Barracuda in 2010 by Anna Mihalovic. And I'm sorry if I pronounced that name incorrectly, Anna. And it was dedicated to the Bulgarian percussionist Tatiana Koleva. And this piece is sort of yet another reworking of the exact same material. So the marimba part is basically the same as the concerto and the solo, and it's accompanied by a percussion sextet, so seven players total, hence the title. The other piece I wanted to talk about today was the one that I saw their recording of, and it's called Gold Rush. Gold Rush was originally written as a duo for the Safri Duo in 1995. It's this gigantic percussion setup that includes marimba and vibraphone as sort of the two main instruments, but also crotales, woodblocks, cymbals, timpani, kick drum, bongos, timbales, taigongs, rototoms, and a few more instruments that I didn't feel like listing off. So the Safri Duo started performing this once it was written in 1995. It had tons of successful performances, and they even titled their fourth album after it. They liked the piece so much that they asked Jacob Tivy to write a concerto based on it. So in 1997, he created a three-movement concerto called the Gold Rush Concerto that is based on the original piece, but it is not sort of a direct transcription like Barracuda Concerto and Solo are. And Jacob Tivy says, it tells the story of people searching for gold, both literally but also metaphorically, as a metaphor for happiness. And the second and third movements of the concerto, it's really cool. They contain samples of an old movie called The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, starring Humphrey Bogart. And these samples are triggered by drum pads, and they're like little text snippets about searching for gold. So it's pretty cool stuff. But mostly right now, I just wanted to hear the duo here talk about preparing that piece Gold Rush, because first of all, where did you rehearse this gigantic setup? And second of all, like, how did you like tour and perform with it?
Well, we were actually quite lucky. Yeah. We started when we were still at school in Amsterdam Conservatory. And the facility here is just unbelievable. We had enough rooms, we had enough instruments, we had our own setup without anybody destroying it at any time. And the school was being really supportive for our first tour in Holland, so we could borrow instruments.
Did we? No, we didn't.
We borrowed a few.
Maybe the remote hi-hat or something.
Yeah, they actually.
The remote hi-hat, that's very difficult. Nobody had.
They even bought it for us.
Oh, yeah. But just that one.
Yeah.
And we had this wonderful, we fell in love with the gongs from a gamelan set. Like the whole last part of Gold Rush has this low, it has a pedal of a low F gong, like the, I don't know, what, 3 feet? Or
bigger,
I don't know.
The screen.
It's quite huge. And so the percussion rattle shop here in Amsterdam, they only had the Bali gongs. So, I think that's what they call it. Yeah, the Thai gong. But the ones with the shiny nipple, the Javanese gongs, they're so beautiful. But they only come in the whole set. So, and they even allowed us to take it out of the whole gamelan set so we could play with them. Never found such amazing gongs anymore after that. But yeah, after we played this, so we toured with this there were 9 concerts, and we had a person helping us transport. Like that was really nice. We still like set up everything, but the transport somebody else did for us. But I think I was so exhausted after that I felt like we're not gonna play this piece anymore. But this year we started again. Yeah, we just played it in September in Luxembourg, and we're gonna play it also now in China again. And yeah, after like a 5-year break, we took it out again. But there's just no way to reduce the setup. Like,
yeah,
I've seen versions where maybe they take like pads for the timpani, or they play actually like electronic pads for the gongs. There's just something about the quality of this, when the timpani, real timpani in the setup, that just makes it so much more beautiful.
Yeah,
but it's a real pain, because you cannot play anything else in this setup. So we usually program it at the beginning of the second half, because then you can use the break of the concert to set up the whole piece. And because it cannot be anywhere else, otherwise you need like 10 minutes to set it up. And
yeah. I remember when I saw your recording, I was just so taken by it. It's such a killer performance, and I wanted to play it. And I actually asked my friend Carly if she would play it. And she said no, mostly because of the setup thing.
It's a constant struggle about like answering the question. Is the music worth all the instruments? And sometimes it's yes, sometimes like we're tired, but like this year, yes again, and we really want to play it again, because just such an amazing piece.
You know, it's a piece, of course, without any playback, and Jacob TV is really known for his boombox pieces like Grab It, mm-hmm. Body of Your Dreams, and Jesus is Coming, and I think mm-hmm. we all probably really, really like those pieces. I know I really, really like those pieces. Can you guys say anything interesting about how he writes without those, all that playback? Because it's a very, very different piece. Gold Rush I've heard maybe actually just once ever. My friends at Rice played it. Grant Biner and Greg Salikas did it once. And I don't even know if I would recognize it as Jacob TV unless I really knew his style well. Do you have anything you could say about that?
Well, I think I tried to like go as electronic as possible with the setup. I guess we just had the conversation with somebody yesterday, like about like if a composer writes temple block, does he really want temple block? Or does he really want wood block, right? And I think in this case, if Jacob TV writes temple block, he actually means poly block. I mean, there's plastic ones,
the black
right?
Ones.
Yeah, so there's that give really clean, sign tone, a little woody. So you don't want to have like these round ones, but you want like like this.
Yeah.
And the drum players use for Latin music. And for instance, then there's an effect where you put like a splash cymbal on top of them, of the timpani, and so you hit them with two sticks together. So you always have like this. It's like almost like on a keyboard when you press one key and there's like this orchestra hits going, like timpani and splash cymbal together. And then I always like, I tighten the splash cymbal very. Very tightly, yeah, very tight. And so that it's really almost like a limiter on the splash cymbal. So you go like shh, kind of sounds. And then as plasticky as the timpani heads can be, like it, I think it's the better. If you had like a natural skin, I think it would ruin the piece a little bit. Like it has to be like plastic skins. And so like, yeah, you can go around the setup and change a little bit. I think the bongos should be fiber skin really. And like the girls, like as... Yeah.
No, so literally we changed the bass drum to a bass box.
Oh yeah, we found this like I think this is we found this bass box. I think like a German company is making this. It's just like a cajon that you hit with a pedal.
Yeah, right.
Yeah, the kick drum, together with the marimba and vibraphone, it was always a little bit too boomy, a little bit too loud. And so we found this cajon with the pedal. That and it just fits under the vibraphone also. You don't have this problem of putting the bass drum under the vibraphone. I think that makes it much better.
It's cool to find those little tricks. It's neat to find all those allowances, like knowing he writes in this other style where that favors so much electronic sounds and all these speech playback. It's neat to be inspired by like the composer's other big body of work.
And he gives you the space. I think he writes either wood blocks, temple blocks, or cowbell even, and they should sound tick tack tock. I think he wrote in the score.
Oh,
so he
right.
actually
okay.
gives you the syllables that you should hear.
Yeah, right.
And not the exact instrument or the pitch even.
Yeah, and then also at the end, it either could be a few high-pitched gongs or their exact pitch, or it could be singing bows. So basically just want this long, constant ringy sound in the background.
Mm-hmm. Oh, so for the tom-tom part, I think you can use any kind of drum you would think sounds nice with marimba mallets, because like not every drum sounds nice playing with marimba mallets. So I'll use like a dumbek, like not actually tom toms that it's written. So I use a dumbek. It gives a little bit more like an edge to the sound.
Yeah, sure. Megan, I think you have a Facebook question there, right?
Yeah, sure. We've got a Facebook question from Beverly Johnston, and she's saying, first she comments, two great musicians, and then she asks, do you have any upcoming tours in North America?
Actually, in the next May.
Next May.
Yeah. 2018, right?
Yeah, in May 2018. Yeah.
Okay.
So Nancy Zeltzman invited us to go to her festival, which will happen in Boston. The Boston Conservatory at Berkeley, it's called now. Yeah.
Do you remember the dates for that? I know it's a shorter festival next summer, right?
Yeah, it's the ZMF on tour.
Can I look?
Yeah, it's the on tour version, which is about five days. Yeah. It's like half portion. Love, I just went to check.
So what does that mean on tour? Is it in several locations?
The on tour is basically for students who really want to come to the ZMF but can't really afford to travel around. So we could bring the festival to a different location. It's easier for the people around that area.
Awesome.
So, yeah. Yeah, it's just a smaller, like you get a taste of it.
Mm-hmm. I think that's cool because it can be so expensive to attend as a student, you know, when it's 2 weeks long and you're flying somewhere. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Probably reaches a different, crowd of people too that way.
Yes.
Probably changes it up for her also. That's cool.
How often do you guys perform at ZMF? I know I've been at ZMF with you before. How often does that happen for you?
Two or three times. Oh, well, we also actually, we were organizing a little bit this ZMF on tour, the first on tour at Japan. I brought them to China, so we were organizing a little, like, on-tour version in China. And then Laurent, last year, 2 years ago, organized a little on-tour in Luxembourg. And then, yeah, we were in the States for, like,
twice or three times.
Yeah.
Casey and Laurel, is that how you guys met them? Is that...
We did, yeah. Rachel was there.
Awesome.
I was there.
Was it that ZMF, Laura? Was it the one we watched Rachel play at?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I guess so. Yeah.
Yeah. He was just talking about the other day, Rachel, the concert where you had to play Velocities and it was like midnight or something.
Oh, yeah.
If you remember that, I remember you were like backstage asleep.
Oh, yes.
It was late.
It was really late concert. Yeah, that was the time we met Casey. I met Casey also first time there.
Well, speaking of Laurel, I think you have a little topic for us today, right?
I do. So upon thinking about Laurent and Rachel and all the things that they do, I remembered, okay, well, they're both like brilliant players, but they also both speak multiple languages. And so that got me thinking about, you know, the brain, and is there a study about rhythm and language, and I found one. And so before I reveal this study, which was published earlier just this year, I wanted to ask Rachel and Laurent about when you were kids growing up, because I know you grew up in like totally different countries. Did you have music class in school along with everything else? And was it a normal thing, or is it something that you did outside of your regular schooling?
Well, I was very fortunate. My parents, they're like amateur musicians, and we have this like wind band tradition. And so I grew up in a small village with like 3,000 people, but we had like a wind band, and my grandparents were in there and my parents were in there, and everybody kind of like, yeah, a lot of people, my sisters and my uncle, they all were in there. And so they took me when I was like 4 years old, and it was not really some kind of solfège, but it was just, you learn about music already at the age of four. And then I remember when they were 7 and 8, they put you in front of the wind band. I said, like, so which one do you want to learn now? And so you had to choose from all these instruments. And and I chose percussion because, like, I didn't want to lose all my air with all those wind instruments. I think I was afraid back then that if you're blowing these instruments, then you lose all your air and you don't have it anymore. And, so there was no piano, no strings, there was nothing else because it's a wind band. So then, of course, I choose the only one where you don't need air. that was a big part of, and I started already the conservatory education when I was 9. Yeah, you can start when you're 9 at the conservatory. And that's a pretty tough system. Mm-hmm. Because now I'm teaching in that system also. So I'm seeing it from the other side now and comparing it to other countries. It's a very, very tough system with lots of exams you have to pass already when you're like, you have to take solfège. And already I remember when I was 13, I was really good at like reading like 7 different keys. That was the height of my, because now I cannot do that anymore. Like the C clef third row and fourth row and the F clef in the third row. I cannot do that anymore. But back then it was really, really tight. Also tough, like theoretically. I have passed exams also in the percussion every 2 years. So that's like basically the education I did. Like I think it was okay because I could like swim with the system, but I think it also like on the other side, it's really, really hard for other people because there's no other possibility. There's no other possibility in Luxembourg to take music lessons because they're all for free. Like the government is like, sponsoring those music lessons. So it's either that or there's not really anything else you can do. Because nobody would teach private lessons because they also go to the conservatory because it's for free.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, exactly. And yeah, you were asking basically about languages as well.
Yeah, when did you start learning? Because you speak like 5 languages or something, right?
Yeah. So we have like Luxembourgish as our mother tongue, which is basically it's like a variation of German, but with like lots of French words, French vocabulary mixed into it. And then we start learning German in school, and just a year later, French. And then when we go to high school, we start English. Those are the 4 languages that most everybody speaks in Luxembourg. And then just later, I added some Dutch and some Chinese now with Rachel. And I have never thought about how this influences actually my musical development. I've never really thought about it. This is a new topic that you are throwing out to me now. I know that lots of people that speak Luxembourgish, they have Luxembourgish has more the meter of German language, and when they speak French, they use that meter to put it on the French language, and then it sounds very, I mean, it doesn't, it sounds very like a foreigner speaking French. So because there's actually with my name, there's the same thing with my name, because in French it would be Laurent, so the accent would be on the second syllable. But in Luxembourg, we say Laurent, so it would be on the first one, which is more like the German way, because they always put them in the first syllables. And how that influences musical, I'm not really sure. But we are, between those German and French traditions, we're like, especially also in the percussion, we're like torn between, like, we set up our timpani in the French way, but like we also have German methods, and like nobody really... I mean, there's a lot of people that teach the roughs in the French way, so like really close. But there's also, I mean, there's just lots of rudimental things going on where you want it more like open. And like, so we mix everything together, basically.
Yeah.
I don't know, Rachel, what do you want to say?
So, well, my story is a little different. Well, I grew up in China, where somehow at that time, all your parents want kids to have like early music education, but we don't really have a school to go to, so we only take private lessons. My dad had a piano bought for me when I was in my mom's belly, and but that also has to do with his passion towards music. He always loved music so much, but he really never learned it. So he thought, well, it would be nice for my kid. And I had to go to learn the piano when I was 3 years old. Of course, I didn't know. My dad used to play fun games with me, try to get me into like the musical world. For example, he would be like, okay, I will play an A on the piano now and see who remembers it the longest. So for me, it was really just a game. And I didn't even know, why do I have to remember A? Why not a C? Why not a D? But he said A, well, I went with it. And then he left home. He said, well, no touching during this time, okay? Just try to remember it. I said, okay. And then, of course, I found out that back then our home phone, when I pick it up, there is a constant beeping, and that was the A. So I wasn't going to touch the piano, so I just left the telephone. Like a day or two, I just remembered it. Mm-hmm. And then speaking of you know, language and music, I think Chinese language is a really tone, like intonation language. It requires a lot of pitches. And when I was 5th grade, I changed to a music school. In the music school, I think that's the earliest age that you can apply there. And in my class, there were 16 people. Out of 16, 14 had a perfect pitch.
Wow.
Wow.
So it was nothing special there. And people could, like, ear training class, the teacher doesn't really know what to do with us because he would play three note chords or four note chords and everybody could just write it down. And I was kind of late for that. I was fifth grade. I went to the school. But all those kids in my class, they somehow knew about, like, you know, ear training music theories already. And they could even write the name of the chords. So I have to pick it up just by myself because there was no course about that anymore. People already know. But then now I think back then I actually didn't need much time to pick it up. Within, I don't know, 2 weeks, I got the system and then I just write it. I don't know why, but people say, is that? So I write that. So I guess music in early age with the Chinese language probably helps a little bit in that case.
Wow.
Yeah. But by the fifth grade, I switched to percussion because I thought that's really cool. I went to the music school. There were so many piano players and very few percussionists. And then I thought, I didn't really know what is percussion, but then I just saw all these instruments, and then I was like, so I could play all of them? And then they're like, yes. So I was like, okay, I'll do that.
Yeah.
For me, it was more like, oh, that's fun. I have more things to play. And then later on, of course, once I started, I discovered my love with the percussion.
Oh, cool. Thanks, guys, because it's so interesting to hear how other countries think about music when you're young. In the States, you know, we all, the three of us, we know what happens, and everybody listening knows what happens, and it so often becomes something that we have to defend of, like, no, music matters. And I think all of us would say, no, you can study music just because music matters, but we so often find the need to defend of why it's useful, you know, and why it's good for the brain. And I think the study that I found is very much along those lines. So this was a study done, well, published this year. I'm not quite sure how long the arc was between beginning to now, but it was done at the Northwestern University. It's titled Individual Differences in Rhythm Skills, Links with Neural Consistency and Linguistic Ability. And it was published in the Journal of Cognitive Neuroscience, Volume 29, Number 5, just earlier this year. So here's a little bit from the abstract. Quote, durational patterns provide cues to linguistic structure. Thus, so variations in rhythm skills may have consequences for language development. Understanding individual differences in rhythm skills, therefore, could help explain variability in language abilities across the population. We hypothesized that rhythm skills that require integration of information across time rely upon the consistency of slow, low-frequency auditory processing. We hypothesized that rhythm skills that require fine temporal precision rely upon the consistency of fast, higher-frequency auditory processing. So rhythm sequencing and synchronization were linked to the consistency of slow cortical and fast frequency following responses, respectively. So really quickly, for them, rhythm sequencing has to do with participants of the study being able to hear a rhythm and play it back or play with it. So maybe like a 4-beat pattern that they had to figure out and then be able to execute. When they talk about synchronization, they just mean like, here's a met, can you stay with it? That kind of stuff. And when they say slow reactions, they're actually talking about things that take about half a second to deal with or more. Mm-hmm. And fast reactions are about 10 milliseconds per reaction. So like so fast that you can't even realize that you're doing it. Furthermore, whereas rhythm sequencing ability was linked to verbal memory and reading, synchronization ability was linked only to nonverbal auditory temporal processing. So in terms of those two things of being able to play a rhythm over time versus just matching it or matching a beat, being able to do something over time had much more to do with people's language skills than just being able to match a metronome. So thus, they say rhythm perception at different time scales reflects distinct abilities, which rely on distinct auditory neural resources. And in young adults, slow rhythmic processing makes the more extensive contribution to language skills. And that's the end of the abstract. And there's a decent amount of research on this connection of rhythm and language because they both mark important events and ends of phrases the same way, you know, whether with longer elements or a pause. You know, when you finish a sentence, you take a pause before beginning again, and strong and weak elements in terms of our accents on certain syllables of words or certain parts of sentences to make sure that we're communicating clearly. So this study is just a part of that whole lineage of understanding. And to quote something else from the article, they say mounting evidence suggests that rhythmic deficits are tied to language impairment. Abnormally poor reading and phonological awareness have been linked to difficulties with rhythm skills as diverse as synchronization, beat extraction, metric perception, rhythm memory, and rhythm discrimination. And answering the question of which rhythmic abilities map to which language functions could suggest the neural resources that are being used for both of those things, which is exciting because it means that in the future we could take those who have language impairments and help them through targeted rhythm training. And wow, so right.
That's cool.
Yeah.
That's like so cool.
It's like really cool. And I think it's the kind of thing that it's like, yes, please do more studies like this, because we can argue about why music matters all the time, but you can't argue with a study like this, you know,
yeah,
of how it actually affects people. So just a little bit about the method of the study. I've kind of given you like the meat of it already,
right?
But they had so they did lots of tests, rhythmic tests, language tests, cognitive and perceptual tests for 64 people who all live kind of around Chicago. And the average age was 18. There were 34 men, 30 women, and no one had any sort of learning disability or language disability. So everyone was on an even playing field when it came to that. The tests used a program called MATLAB, which is very common among, I think, studies. And then the program Audacity, which we all probably know and have worked with, did a lot in terms of recording responses in separate channels so that it could be analyzed as accurately as possible. I'm just going to tell you about the rhythm tests, not any of the others, because I think those are the most interesting to us. So synchronization is maintain a steady beat with the metronome. So they would play a track of either a snare drum or a conga sound, and people had to play on a conga in front of them that had all these sensors on it to make sure that they were getting the most exact reading of when they would hit. And they just had to play steady with a metronome. Easy peasy. Second test was tempo adaptation, where they would just randomly tweak the tempo of the metronome once, and people had to adjust to it. Timing adaptation was where they would... It's as if the metronome messed up and it would play one too close to the one previous, but then be in the correct tempo after that. Beat synchronization, they had to listen to a groove and then be able to find where the beat was. Mm-hmm. And they had different patterns for that. They called some of them metrically strong and some of them metrically weak. So probably some are, you know, disco type grooves, and then others had a bit more syncopation to them. Mm-hmm. When it comes to the sequencing tests, so these are the long-term rhythm tests. There was drumming to a sequence, which involved, you know, some repetitive pattern. And I actually looked it up. I found it. One of them was 1 and a 2, a 3 and 4. That's what people had to listen to. And
I love
then be
that
able
rhythm.
To match it. Huh?
I love that rhythm.
It's of all
Casey's
the rhythms,
favorite.
That's the best rhythm they could have chosen. Yeah. And so it's like totally by rote, right? Just play it when you hear it. And the margin of error there was pretty wide. I think they said as long as it was within 200 milliseconds, they counted it as correct, which I know sounds like a lot, but you know, in terms of professional music world, like you're off by that much and you're like, you're out, you know? So it was pretty loosey goosey in terms of how people had to perform these. And then the last one is called sequence memory. So they would have to hear a sequence three times and then perform it that last time still in time, quote unquote. Yeah. So all things that, you know, are very simple to us and that we've been doing since we were like really, really young kids. But we're used here to connect with language and cognitive and perceptual tests. And here's a little more about what they found. In terms of the rhythm test, the first three, which all had to do with the Met, just tapping along with the Met, were really correlated. And beat synchronization, which was finding the beat among a groove, correlated with everything except sequence. And when it came to the sequence memory, which is the one you could just do by rote and you didn't have to process quite the same way, that one kind of stood on its own. And to me, that's very interesting because you meet a lot of people who can do things by rote if they've heard it. But then when it comes to a bit of autonomy, it's nowhere to be found. And it's, you know, the study says, oh, well, it's because it's a completely different process. Sequencing performance linked to reading and verbal memory. But the participants with higher rhythm sequence factor scores were more proficient on a number of language and cognitive measures, including auditory working memory, word reading, and non-word reading. So like nonsense words, like supercalifragilisticexpialidocious. Those types of things. And then lastly, this is kind of the closing of the study. The links reported here between rhythm sequencing and language skills join a growing body of work, suggesting shared foundation for these two seemingly disparate sets of skills. The perception of rhythm sequences has also been linked to individual differences in grammar and phonological skills, and experience with multiple languages is linked to enhanced perception of musical rhythms. So that's kind of cool there at the end because it means, yeah, you're going to have an easier time learning multiple languages if you're good at rhythm. But at the same time, if you speak multiple languages, you're probably going to discern rhythm better because it's the same mechanism having to do with the same auditory thing. So I just think it was so cool. And I know that was probably a bit long-winded explanation. Yeah, Ben says, Laurel's so smart right now. Yeah. Laurel just like reads what smart people write.
This is very interesting. I would really like to do this with my students because like Luxembourg City is such an international place. Like there's like, I think 70 or 75% of people actually not Luxembourgish in the city. And actually my students also, I teach in English, in French, in German, and in Luxembourgish. And I actually like have also like, I have people from Russia, from China, from wow. Bulgaria, from Romania, like from Greece, from all over the place. And they all speak multiple languages. And actually, I would love to do that kind of study with them. There's probably nobody that just speaks one language. And probably interesting to do it, yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds so connected to me. Most people in America only speak one language. I only speak one. I've tried to learn two others and it's so hard.
Yeah.
Laurel, it's pathetic is. how I just don't remember languages. Like I go to various, go to Portugal, go to Italy, go to Germany, go to Taiwan, and like nothing sticks.
It's exposure, you know. We're just not.
Yeah, I guess.
Unless we create an environment for ourselves, which is difficult to do.
Yeah.
But you know, whether you're you know hanging out with a crowd of people that are not using English.
But you know they also say pass. I heard this on somewhere just literally yesterday, very recently. The elasticity of your brain stops after age like late 20s, 30. So and they cite language specifically is so hard to learn after that point.
You hear that a lot and you wonder if that's similar. I mean, I think it's similar in other things, but if that, I'm sure that plays into this study too.
Yeah, and there are, you know, there are so many things that say in terms of understanding language's structure and phonemes and things like that, by the time you've reached adolescence, you're almost at the cusp of how easily you'll be able to learn those connections in the brain. And so if, it's like, if you really haven't done it by the time you're 15, it is going to be even harder to learn. And then there's another barrier, like Casey just said, where you lose the elasticity. And so it's like you have the easy time until adolescence, and then there's like young adult time where it's harder, and then there's where it's just, yeah, good luck, you know?
Yeah. Well, well, I guess that's a question for you guys too, is like, you know, you said that you're learning some Chinese and Dutch now. Do you think it's harder? You're finding it harder to learn languages now than when you were younger?
Dutch wasn't very difficult. I mean, I don't speak Dutch perfectly. I couldn't teach in Dutch or something, but like just to normal.
Understand, get around, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, I understand everything. But with Chinese, it's just a different language. There's no words which are a little bit similar. Like even in German and English, you have words, or in French, you have words which are the same, or at least start with the same letter because they have the same roots. But in Chinese, it's just zero. Yeah, so I'm not sure if it's my brain is not elastic anymore. It's just the language that is super hard.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, and just so different. Yeah, I also just cannot process how people keep more than even. I mean, two languages are amazing to me, but my best friend who lives in China right now, she speaks, I think, five different languages. And I had a student in Jordan who spoke five languages regularly, like on a daily basis. She was using five languages in different parts of her life. And I just like, I just cannot, like I learned, you know, some Arabic when I was there. And then now I'm working on some Spanish, and it's like, I literally have to erase the Arabic word from my brain and insert the Spanish word. I just don't know how you do it. I just don't.
What actually helps me is like that, like I use one language with one person. So I got to know Rachel with English, and even now I learned some Chinese. We use English, and even if she would speak some Luxembourgish or any other language, we stick to English. This is our language. And so also when I think about her or something, I think in English, actually not in my mother tongue, but like in English. And the same with the students. They also speak a few languages, but once I start, like the student enters, there's every half or every hour, there's somebody else coming in. It's like, oh, that language, then never change. I think it will help the brain actually to just stick with that.
I'd love to see in this test, Laurel, if they could somehow find people who, you know, spoke no languages somehow. They were totally isolated from society and never developed any language. If they could find a pulse, because it's amazing teaching, say, music appreciation to a class of 50 non-musicians, and you say like, okay, guys, so the term next is beat and pulse, and they can all always find the beat, they can all always find the pulse. So it's, I got to wonder how much is that credit just due to, though, they have a command of a language, so maybe.
I know there have been case studies where they found, you know, these horrible situations of someone that was isolated, like their parents, you know, was abusive, they locked them in a closet sort of thing. And I remember learning about one in a psychology class, and like, as she got older, she had trouble, she couldn't use pronouns, like something about using pronouns was just odd to her. So she couldn't say like, I did this, but she could learn language. So yeah, I mean, there's, I don't think they've done musical studies necessarily, but there is precedent for that.
We better test it.
That'd be really interesting. There's a lot of studies, you know, I kind of looked through the bibliography, and there's a lot about dyslexia in rhythm. That's kind of interesting to me.
Let's end with a question. We got a question from Theodore Milkov. He's a friend of the podcast. Some of you who are interested in marimba might have heard of this fella. But Theo says, how does your family life affect your stage life, if at all? P.S. See you soon at ZMF.
I think it doesn't affect at all, because we don't really think about it. I think we have this one theory that actually, we're very opposite. So everyone actually really never really in a competition. So the competition is completely out. And so like whenever there's a problem, like we have this theory that like I'm more like going with the left side of my brain, and Rachel's going more with the right side of her brain. So they're complementary, mm-hmm. and so like the more I'm more like the rational part, and Rachel more the emotional part or whatever. Yeah. Something like this. There's so many words to describe this.
Ever since Beverly brought it up in ZMF a few years ago, this just kept going. And how I remember is just Laurent is left. So, yeah, we barely have conflicts, mm-hmm. actually. We have a completely different approach to things. Mm-hmm. But then we also... We learn the other side from each other. And actually, seriously, before I saw Theo's question, I never thought of it. Mm-hmm. And then after I saw he posed a question, I started to think. And then I thought, well, since I never thought of it, I guess it's not very much affected.
Right.
In any side. And also because we knew each other since, I don't know, 2011, we started. 2007. And we started to play together first. So we had a duo first after a long time because we hang out all the time. We play together all the time. And then we got to know each other very well. Then we got together. So all the problem could have had already happened. So,
right.
Yeah.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Well, and I guess Laurel and I get that question a lot, too. Like, oh, you work with your wife. Is that, you know, I love my wife, but are you sure you want to work with your wife? And, yeah, I always find the question a little confusing. You know, it's, well, yeah, it's fine. It's great. I mean, it's not like we're in this high-pressure situation where we would, I don't know, possibly get on each other's nerves. It seems pretty, mm-hmm. pretty easy, you know?
Well, there's something about, like, you liked them enough to marry them. Don't you also like them enough to work with them?
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
And there's so much to be shared, like the good aspects and the bad aspects. Like you can share the joy of a performance, but you can also share maybe the doubts you had about yourself, the stress and setting up the marimba. And there's so many things to be shared. Also, I think it factors also the attitude you have towards your job. I mean, it's a passion. It's almost a hobby. Like it's a passion you share, and so it doesn't really matter if you're friends or exactly your family or I mean, there's no difference between those things.
Yeah, wonderful. Well, you know, that's a really nice statement and probably a really good place to end it. So you guys keep an eye out for Joint Venture Percussion Duo and all the things they're doing. And yeah, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you. Thank you, all of you.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
Bye. Bye.